Well, good afternoon and good morning for those of you on the West Coast. I'm Randy Capps, Director of Research for U.S. Programs at Migration Policy Institute. Well, I want to welcome everyone to the call, Young Refugee Children, Their Schooling Experiences in the United States and in Countries of First Asylum. Before we begin, I have a few housekeeping notes. The audio and PowerPoint for the webinar will be on our website later today. You can find them at migrationpolicy.org/events. The papers are also all available now on our website and are listed here on this slide. If you have any technical problems, please email events@migrationpolicy.org or call 202-266-1929. If you have problems hearing via the web, please dial in using the call information that was provided. We will have a question and answer session at the end of the call. It will not be by voice. Please type any questions into the Q&A or the chat box, which are both located on the right-hand side of your screen, and send them to us, or else email to events@migrationpolicy.org. Following my introductory remarks, we will have three presenters here today. Selçuk Syrian, who is Associate Professor of Applied Psychology at New York University, lead author on the first paper. Sarah Dryden-Peterson, Assistant Professor at Harvard Graduate School of Education, and then Dina Berman, Associate Professor of Educational and Psychological Studies at University of Miami. Now, I'd like to say a few words to put the research described today into context. And here again are the three reports. The world is facing a refugee crisis that is unprecedented since World War II. There are an estimated 19.5 million refugees worldwide, and just over half of them are children. Refugee children face all the vulnerabilities associated with conflict and flight from conflict, trauma, physical harm, violence, separation from families, economic deprivation, but additionally, they often lose their access to education. The three reports being presented today reflect different elements of the global crisis in refugee education. The first paper by Selçuk Syrian and Lauren Rogers Syrian focuses on Syrian refugee children in the neighboring countries of Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon. These three, like other countries of First Asylum around the world, have taken in far more refugees than wealthier countries like the United States. Their governments are struggling to provide basic education to the millions of Syrian children living there. This paper focuses on educational struggles as well as some findings regarding the mental health of Syrian refugee children at a camp in Turkey. As the war in Syria drags on, Europe, Canada, Australia, and the US will resettle increasing numbers of Syrian refugee children, but Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon will continue to be the first line of refuge for most of these children. The second report provides a global overview of refugee children's education in different countries of First Asylum. The author, Sarah Dryden-Peterson, has visited refugee camps in Africa and Asia where she observed classroom instruction. Developing countries such as Kenya have had large refugee camps for many years, even decades, and millions of children have spent their entire childhood in these camps. As with Syrian refugee children, other refugee children have difficulty accessing education in these settings due to lack of classroom space, lack of teachers, language difficulties, and often political discord between the refugee groups and host countries. All these problems carry over to refugee children resettled in the U.S. and elsewhere, as the children may have had large gaps in formal education, studied in multiple languages, received poor quality instruction, and faced discrimination. The third report by Dina Berman and Nellie Tran brings the story home to the United States. The authors conducted an in-depth study of a U.S. elementary school serving a large refugee population from Somalia. At the school, students experienced multiple academic and behavioral difficulties due to lack of prior schooling, significant language barriers, and unfamiliarity with structures and norms of schools. As a result, these students appeared to be disengaged in school, even though their lack of engagement was more a function of unfamiliarity with school settings than a lack of willingness to learn. These three reports provide lessons learned from the United States and abroad about the difficulties facing educators with refugee students in their classrooms. They recommend strategies to improve support for refugee education in countries of first asylum, as well as teaching strategies to better serve children once they arrive in the United States. The three reports were previously presented at a workshop of scholars that included a broad range of disciplines held at MPI earlier this year. The workshop, the papers, and this webinar are all part of a multi-year project studying the well-being of young children in refugee families that was supported by the Foundation for Child Development, which is based in New York City. Please stay tuned for the release of more papers about young children of refugees later this year, including a demographic overview of children in refugee families, an assessment of health and nutrition of refugee children, and analysis of the access of these children to early childhood education and care programs. Now, to get started with the current webinar, I would like to turn it over to the first presenter, Selçuk Syrian.
Thank you, this is Selçuk. When I first started talking about this population, Syrian refugees, this first slide was different. It started with around 400,000 people. That's when I first gave my first presentation. And only about three months ago, I gave another presentation on this population. This slide was different back then. It was around 3 million people. So as of today, and this changes every day, as of today, as of last week, in fact, the number of Syrian refugees living abroad is about 4.2 million. These are registered Syrian refugees. Half of this number currently is in Turkey, about 1.1 million in Lebanon, and about 600,000 people, refugees from Syria, are in Jordan. These three countries collectively has almost 70 to 80% of the Syrian refugees living abroad. About half, 40-43, depending on how you count it, are of this population are under 18 and considered children, and 40% are under age 12, which are young children. So we are talking about 50% children under 18, 40% under age 12. In terms of the U.S. context for this population, we only have about, you know, less than 2,000 Syrian refugees settled so far as of October 20, and the applications through UNHCR is about just under 20,000. We are talking about a huge crisis, obviously, and why we are not getting a lot of applicants or to the U.S. Part of the reason is bureaucratic. It takes up to 2 years to get through the system in United States, and it's a bit faster in the rest of the world, especially in Europe and some of the entry countries. However, partly because of the recent outcry that came out of that very infamous picture on the beach in Turkey, there is a demand to increase this number to 10,000 for the fiscal year 2016, and the ceiling for refugees coming to United States, you know, from 70 to 85,000 and maybe 100,000, this is currently still being debated in the Congress. Okay, so I want the next two slides. One slide I'm going to talk about educational needs, the next one mental health needs. Syria was a huge success story in terms of schooling. You know, more than 90% of children in Syria were schooled, which is probably one of the highest percentage in the region, certainly way higher than the rest of their neighboring countries, almost competing with Turkey. Unfortunately, after the civil war, we are talking about right now about more than 50% of Syrian refugees are not enrolled in school. So we are talking about a group of a cohort whose parents and any older generation went to school and significant number of years in schooling. And now, unfortunately, we have a huge population who are not schooled or in school as of this year. Net enrollment for Syrian refugees in Lebanon is about 20%, in Turkey is about 30%, Jordan has the highest number partly because Jordan has a smaller number of refugees, and also they have more infrastructure to deal with refugees and the language, which I will talk about in the next slide. Enrollment varies by setting and gender. Unfortunately, girls are not as high, are not represented in schools in terms of enrollment, especially when we get to early teen years, they are not schooled at all. And also in refugee camps, you have higher percentage of children going to school versus non-refugee camps. The case in Turkey is very interesting. 83% of children who are currently in refugee camps are going to some kind of formal school. Only 15% go to school when they are not in refugee camps. And the trend is that they live in refugee camps for a short period of time, and then they leave the camps for job and other purposes. So children are losing their schooling when they leave the camp. There are many barriers to schooling, school enrollment. One of them is financial. You know, even when they are sending their kids to a public school, you still have costs for uniforms, books, transportation in particular. When they are not living on camps, they are probably living in areas where schooling may or may not be open to them. Language is a huge barrier, especially for Turkey, because Turkish education is based on Turkish, and this Syrian refugees speak Arabic, and we don't have, I am native of Turkey, so I'm saying we do not have Arabic-speaking teachers or any staff to help them. So that's a huge barrier in Turkey, and remember, half the refugees from Syria are currently in Turkey, so one of the major barriers for education is language. For those who are in Turkey. Jordan, you have Arabic, which is very good for Syrian refugees. That's why the percentage of enrollment is higher in Jordan. In Lebanon, they are instructed in French or English, and sometimes in Arabic, which is a problem for some. There are also legal problems. Some parents fail to demonstrate their refugee status. And also, it's very difficult to verify prior education. So, especially if they are transitioning from elementary to middle, from middle to high school, and to college as well, diplomas are not cannot be verified. So, that's a huge barrier to get students enrolled in the system. There are, of course, economic barriers as well. Most parents do need money to survive. And children are working for the parents, for the family in many cases, you know, sometimes unfortunately begging, and other times for other types of manual labor. I want to tell a bit about my empirical study that we did in 2012. We carried out the first field-based study on Syrian refugee children outside of Syria. This was a refugee camp in Turkey. We gathered data from 311 children at this camp, partnered with UNESCO, Save the Children, and other government agencies. We had three simple goals. One is we wanted to document the trauma. What is it that these children were going through? Secondly, we wanted to identify mental health needs. And finally, we also wanted to give them a chance to express themselves for the rest of the world. Remember, we did this study in 2012, you know, when they were only in hundreds of thousands, not in millions yet. So we wanted to get their story out to the public to get some attention. And these are some of our findings. The report has more details. About 80% had experienced someone die in their family of the population that we studied. More than 60% had experienced a stressful life event where they thought that someone else was in great danger. This is a symptomology checklist that we use to identify and diagnose PTSD. So what we found that about 6% had seen someone get kicked, shot at, or physically hurt. About 44% had experienced 5 or more of these stressful events, and 19% had 7 of these stressful events. Altogether, typically, children in Western nations on average has 3 of these events happen to them, and in our case, it's way over that. Based on this symptom checklist, about 45% can be diagnosed with PTSD symptoms, more than 10 times the rate that you can observe in any children population in the rest of the world when there's no war. The results, however, were comparable to other children experiencing war, especially Palestinian children and Bosnian children. We also did a more creative way of gathering data from children, because you're talking about, you know, children at harm, they have experienced a lot of PTSD. So we gave them another instrument to identify their needs and their symptoms. This was a simple three-question open drawing assignment. In the first question, you ask them to draw a picture of a person. The next one, you ask them to draw a picture of a war zone, and then third one, to draw a picture of a peaceful environment. And the idea is, you know, to what degree that the three types of instructions would yield three different pictures. You will have more examples of this in the report. So this is a drawing of a person. So we simply ask them to draw a person. As you can see, it's very similar to what they would come up with when you ask them to draw a war or peace. I mean, sorry, too fast. So this is a drawing of war, which makes sense. You know, this is a war scene that they have probably witnessed. And this is their experience of peace. In many of the cases, you know, we have more than 300 of this drawings. In many of the cases, the differentiation between person and war is not that different. And in some cases, even peace and war is not that different. So I'm going to pause here for, I'm having problem with controlling. Just to conclude, providing refugees with food and shelter is not enough. If there's something we learn from Afghanistan and from Africa, you know, refugee camps are the number one grounds for recruitment for terrorist organizations. So we have to do more, give them hope, and that means high quality education and mental health care. We're talking about a highly vulnerable at-risk population. Unless you give them quality education and health care, mental health care in particular, we are going to have problem and price to pay. Practitioners in resettlement countries can take several steps to help these children in terms of helping bridge the language and skills gap, training educators to recognize the signs of trauma, which is huge for this particular population, and also help Syrian refugee families access mental health services in wherever they settle. Thank you so much for your attention. And now we move to the next presenter.
Yes, and before we move on to the next presenter, I just want to remind everyone, if you want to submit a question, please submit it through the Q&A box on the right-hand side of your screen, or the chat box on the right-hand side of your screen, or email them the questions to events@migrationpolicy.org. And now I'll turn it over to our second presenter, Sarah Dryden-Peterson.
Great. Thank you so much, Randy, and thanks, Salchuk, for your presentation. I'd like to talk today about some of the lessons that we can learn from other refugee situations globally that can be applied to this unprecedented crisis with Syrian refugees that Salchuk talked about, and also can apply to what U.S. teachers here in the United States should know about the earlier experiences of their refugee students in their classrooms. I'd like to start by providing a brief overview of armed conflict and refugee situations globally. As of 2014, there were 32 armed conflicts in 26 countries. Also important to know is that 86% of refugees are hosted in neighboring countries. So while we see a lot of attention focused on refugees and migrants in North America and Europe, the vast majority of refugees live neighboring their countries of origin. We know that there are 19.2 million refugees today, which is the largest number since World War II, and that half of these refugees are children. We also know that refugees live in a very diverse collection of settings. We talk often about refugee camps, but refugees also live in rural areas amid local populations, and more than half of refugees globally now live in urban areas, which are very different situations from camps in terms of being integrated with national populations. Important also is that the average length of exile for a refugee is 17 years. This means that for any given child, this is their one shot at education. And further, we know that most conflict is cyclical, so that when conflict ends, it often reignites again, as we see in the situation of South Sudan, for example. To describe children's access to primary and secondary education globally, I want to focus on a few elements that really impact on whether or not children can access education. The first relates to laws, and globally, it's important to think about the 1951 Refugee Convention, which provides the framework for refugees' rights as they flee across international borders and seek refuge in a country of first asylum. This convention states that a nation state, will accord to refugees the same treatment as is accorded to nationals with respect to elementary education, and treatment as favorable as possible with respect to education other than elementary education. Important to note is that not all countries have signed the 1951 Refugee Convention, including many countries that host refugees. And further, Article 22, which is the right to education, is not ratified by all countries, even those that have signed the Refugee Convention. And then within this global structure, there are also national laws, policies, and practices that impact on whether or not refugees can access education. These include national laws that restrict where in a country refugees can live, and sometimes those are areas that are very isolated and not within access of schools. There are also policies within countries that inhibit or promote the right to work for families, which can influence how refugees access education, especially in countries where there are fees. Just to give a snapshot of what we know about children's access to primary and secondary education, about 76% of refugees globally have access to primary education, but this ranges quite drastically from 40% in some settings to 100% in some settings. So the global figures only tell us somewhat about what might be going on in a very local context. The numbers at secondary level are even lower, with only 36% of refugees being able to access secondary education, and in some settings, this is as low as 1%. In terms of refugee children resettled in the United States, we know that only 1% of refugees globally are resettled to a third country, and so it's a very small percentage of the refugee population globally. But these numbers are critical as we think about our own national context. There are about 150,000 school-aged refugee children in the United States, and they come from 113 countries of origin. Many languages, many curriculums, many different types of access to education. And important to our current refugee populations, which is quite distinct from historical populations, is that most refugee children arrive in the U.S. with some experience of education in a country after they fled their home country, and that education is an education in a country of first asylum. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about what we've learned from our research in countries of first asylum in terms of children's educational experiences and the kinds of lessons that those experiences hold for U.S. teachers who are attempting to meet the needs of refugee children once they do arrive in the United States. This study draws on data from the UNHCR, which is the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, particularly from the 14 host countries that have the largest refugee populations in the world. Our data, it also consists of semi-structured interviews with key informants and also with educators in countries of first asylum, and field-based ethnographic work with refugee children in classrooms. And these data come from several different sites focused on refugees from the Democratic Republic of Congo living in Uganda and Burundi, from Somalia living in Kenya, from Myanmar living in Bangladesh and Malaysia, and from Syria living in Egypt. I'd like to focus on four categories of experiences that emerge from our data as being critical for U.S. teachers as they educate refugee children in the U.S. These four categories are disrupted schooling, language barriers, quality of instruction, and discrimination in school settings. Refugee children often miss out on school and never catch up. And so even children who have been exposed to education in a country of first asylum often have experiences with interrupted schooling. There are many reasons for this, but the most important among them are acute conflict that interrupts education, closes education systems, or makes it impossible and unsafe to travel to school, legal restrictions on refugees accessing education in a country of first asylum, and ongoing migration as refugees seek further livelihood opportunities and the kinds of futures that they imagine. Just a brief story about a boy who I'll call Amazia, who was a refugee from Democratic Republic of Congo living in Uganda. And he and his family lived in Kampala, which is the capital of Uganda, because his father was an artist and was able to pursue a livelihood there. But at this time, this was 2003, refugees were only resettled to a third country like the United States from a refugee camp. And this family wanted to keep alive that hope that they might someday build a life in the United States. So they kept up a dual residence in the city where they could pursue a current livelihood and in the camp which held their dreams for the future. One year, they needed to register in the refugee camp to keep their dreams of resettlement alive, and that registration process coincided with the high school exams that Amazia had to take. He missed his exams and had to repeat the whole year of schooling as a result. It's also important to note that younger children may never have been enrolled in primary school, and unlikely that older children would have ever been in secondary school, given the access rates globally. And even for those refugee children who do enroll in school, disruptions to their schooling are common for the reasons that I outlined previously. The second factor relates to language barriers in accessing education. Refugee children often experience multiple languages of instruction. This may be as a result of moving from a country where there's one language of instruction, for example, moving from Democratic Republic of Congo where the language of instruction is French, to Uganda where the language of instruction is English. It can also result from shifting language policies. Just briefly, the example of Henri, who was a Burundian refugee living in Tanzania. The policies when he was in primary school were that he follow the Tanzanian curriculum in English and Swahili. But as he began secondary school, the policy changed and he was to follow the Burundian curriculum in French and Kirundi. But there were only Tanzanian teachers, so it was a real mix of languages. Then his village burned down and he moved to another camp where he followed the Congolese curriculum in French. So even one student, multiple curriculums, multiple language of instructions over the course of his educational experience. Also, variable quality of English instruction, especially in situations where refugee teachers are asked to teach in a language that is not their home language and that they have never been educated in. So refugee children who are resettled to the U.S. often have exposure to multiple languages, but academic mastery of none of them. There's also very poor quality of education in most refugee settings. There are limited resources for teaching often, limited numbers of teachers, and limited training opportunities. The instruction is often teacher and not student-centered. One study that we did in Kenya, we observed a total of 53 lessons, and in only 17 of those lessons was any question asked at all by a student, and only 6 of those 53 lessons was more than one question asked. And these questions that were asked, limited as they were all factual, and asking students to recall what they had just been taught by the teacher. This is not always a bad thing. There are many forms of student-centered instruction that can be positive. But the expectations for children in U.S. classrooms are often that they participate in a particular way and that they do ask questions. And oftentimes, limited participation in that way can be seen as a lack of understanding or a lack of engagement rather than an expectation that a student not ask questions. Often low literacy within refugee settings and among teachers. And frequent, what we see is this cycle of poor quality instruction leading to students to drop out and to be absent from school, seeing very little purpose in their ongoing education. So even children with schooling in First Asylum countries may have skills and knowledge below their grade level and little experience with the kind of expectations that many U.S. classrooms have for participation. Finally, the fourth factor that I want to describe is discrimination in school settings. We observe in many countries that schooling can promote or exacerbate tensions. This can come from the content of the curriculum in such ways as refugee children may be learning a foreign history or a history that actually emphasizes tensions related to the conflict that they were fleeing. We also see examples of bullying by teachers and peers based on ethnicity, based on language, based on the relationship between the host country and the country of conflict at a political level, and the kind of political environment that refugees exist within, not just within the schools, but within the country in general. So at a school in Egypt or when talking with Syrian parents living in Egypt, we learned a lot about how refugee children were faced with questions in school by their peers of why they quit Syria, why they were in Egypt, why didn't they go back to their own countries, and faced with situations where Egyptian children would blame the other young children for the economic troubles and the lack of access to goods in Egypt. So much the case that several families described how they decided to take their children out of school because the bullying was worse than no education at all. These kind of prior experiences with discrimination can influence refugees' perceptions of school in general that can carry over to their experiences in the U.S. and the kind of expectations for relationships with peers and teachers even after resettlement. In brief, four lessons really emerge for educators in the U.S. The first is that there are often skill and knowledge gaps among refugee children that result not from a lack of aptitude, but from disrupted schooling, exposure to multiple languages, and limited exposure to academic content. Secondly, is that even if a refugee child has come from an English language education system, it doesn't guarantee that they will be proficient in English, or even that there was much English in their classroom. Third, in many First Asylum countries, there are different expectations for classroom behavior and participation, which can carry over to the way that refugee children believe that they are to behave in classrooms in the U.S. and can be interpreted differently by U.S. teachers. And finally, refugee students may be reluctant to invest in school relationships because of the experiences with discrimination in countries of First Asylum that happened in school settings and the kind of temporariness with which they viewed their education and therefore a lack of investment in developing the kinds of relationships with teachers and peers that might be expected as they come to the U.S. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Sarah. I'd like to remind people, if you do have a question that you'd like to submit for the Q&A session, please look at the Q&A or chat at the right-hand side of your screen or email to events@migrationpolicy.org. With that, I would like to introduce our third presenter, Dina Berman.
Hi, good afternoon. Thank you for this opportunity and for bringing us together, and I'm very struck by the extent to which what I have to say carries over from Sarah's presentation just now, because now we're going to talk about kids once they get to this country. And I want to acknowledge Nellie Tran, who's on the call here too, who was my collaborator on this project. We really immersed ourselves in the life of the school for about 2 years as we studied what was happening to these kids. So there's been a lot of attention, and Sarah talked about it just now, on what have been called psych students, or students with interrupted formal education, students who come out from refugee camps and were not able to continue their education from one grade to the next. However, this study focused on a different group of students who are more extreme than the psych students that we typically talk about, and they are students with limited formal education, these are students who have never been in school. And before I start telling you about the study, I just want to say something about why is it important for us to focus on these kids. And the way that Nellie and I thought about it was that this is a group of students who, in qualitative research language, represent an extreme case. These are kids who not only had interruptions in their education, but they have never had any. And our thinking was that appreciating what they go through and understanding their experience would be informative for us as we think about the range of experiences of education that refugee students come in with as they come into this country. So Somali Bantu kids who were the topic of our study, and again, I just want to preface this by saying when we first started the study, our aim was to try to understand the experience of refugee students in a school and the school's relationship with refugee students. We actually initially thought that we were going to be studying a range of different students from different countries, but as we started the study, Somali Bantu began arriving in the U.S., and because of the issues that they confronted, we ended up focusing on them because that's who the school was most concerned with, and it was a very interesting experience trying to understand what was happening to them. The Somali Bantu are part of the wave of migration that came with the Somali refugees to the U.S., but they were even more extreme and experienced more extreme situations than the Somali refugees because they were an oppressed minority within Somalia. They had originally been brought to Somalia as slaves in the 18th and 19th century, and they continued to live as oppressed minority groups within Somalia. They were primarily agrarian. They came from polygamous families. Their native language, Mai-Mai for most of them, has no written form. They were displaced during the war in Somalia, just as the rest of the Somali refugees had originally lived in the Dadaab refugee camp on the Somali border in Kenya. And then when the decision was made to bring them to the U.S., they were moved to Kakuma refugee camp on the other side of Kenya, and that's where they were processed for resettlement in the U.S. And they started to come in 2004, just as we began this study. So, one framing approach that we brought to the study was from Barbara Rogoff, and she has a book that we relied on a great deal called The Cultural Nature of Human Development, where she talks about the impact of schooling on children, on child development, and on parent-child relationships. And we thought a lot about that because these were children coming into an American school without any experience with schooling. And Rogoff talks about the ways in which formal compulsory schooling essentially transformed adult-child relationships. Whereas before children had been in school, they essentially learned how to work in the fields or do whatever the work was that adults were doing through something that she called intent participation. That is, they were involved with adults in meaningful activities for the purposes of helping adults and apprenticing with them and learning how to do these things. And with the advent of formal schooling, what we've done is we've separated children from adults. We place them in these separate settings that we call schools. We segregate them by age. And learning that they experience now has become decontextualized so that they're asked to, they ask questions such as what is 2 + 2? And this kind of a question, this kind of learning is not directly connected to living in the world outside of the school. And of course, the advent of standardized testing in the U.S. in particular has also transformed schooling to become really what Rogoff calls assembly line instruction, the teaching to the test issues. And the reason that we looked at these theories and thought about them a lot is because we came to see the relationship between the kids coming into the school and the school and the teachers relating to the kids as really a clash of two cultures. And one is the culture and experience of the refugees and what they brought with them, and the other is not only the U.S. culture, but also the culture of schooling, which very much affected what we saw happen. So this was why I already told you about our question. We wanted to understand the challenges that the school faced and the kids faced in working and coming together. And we conducted participant observation. We spent about 2 years in the school intensively spending time there. Nellie and myself spent time, and we also recruited a number of undergraduate students who spent time in the school with us in classrooms, assisting teachers, and getting to know the kids. Our feeling was that the more we became engaged with the school and with the kids, the more we would learn. We tried to be helpful. We were in classrooms. We went on field trips with the kids. And then we interviewed staff, teachers, and refugee families. So the school is located in a very diverse Chicago neighborhood, kind of a gateway community that has traditionally been a place where new immigrants arrive. And the school has had a very long history of working with refugees and immigrants. And but this really was unprecedented for them because they felt that this group was particularly difficult for them to work with because of the backgrounds that they brought with them. So in terms of our findings, with respect to the students, one of the things we really focused on were behavioral incidents. And one of the reasons that we focused on this is because even prior to working with the school, what we had heard from teachers about Somali Bantu kids was that the teachers did not know how to manage the behavior that they saw in the classroom. And at the school, this also emerges of great concern to teachers. And also in our observations and working with the kids, we also confronted this. So it was a very vivid and present issue that we saw. And so behavioral incidents, we tried to describe what was happening in these situations, what was the meaning of what was going on. The way we defined it was these were situations where refugees' children's behavior created a problem for school staff, either because they distracted staff from attending to regular activities or posed a safety concern. And remember, school staff were also very concerned about test scores. So distractions were not seen in a positive light because they took teachers' time away from doing what they felt they needed to do. And here's a list of the kinds of things that we observed as behavioral incidents, and I'm going to give you two examples of those. The one that was most frequent was minor disruptive behavior. And here's a quote. Imagine here's a small group sitting together and working. This is a quote from a teacher. They will get up and walk away or start talking loudly to each other. They ignore what's going on as if the teacher is not there. One of them might get up and walk around. We showed them how to ask permission and go to the bathroom. Now some of them want to go all the time. Another example is hoarding. The kids, certainly from the situation they came from, did a lot of this kind of hoarding activities. And here's an example. One thing he didn't understand was that when he was playing with things, I felt like he would hoard things that he would want. He would want to keep crayons and keep school supplies. He would a lot of times sneak foods out of the lunchroom, and he would stuff like cookies in his pocket, and he would come back in the classroom with 15 cookies in his pocket. So once we described the behavioral incidents, we also really wanted to understand what was happening in terms of the learning of these students, and we focused on this issue of engagement and disengagement and learning. And despite the fact that these kids were, as some of the teachers felt, behavioral problems and, you know, difficult to manage, we also saw many, many instances where these kids were very engaged in learning. They enjoyed learning. They were able to understand and process material, and they really surprised us in how much they were learning and progressing. At the same time, there were times when they were not engaged and disengaged. And here's an example of disengagement. And, of course, testing is was a very, very difficult situation, times when the school expected them to function on standardized tests, for example. So here's an example of a testing situation from one of our students, one of our participant observers. She says, when the test started, I reminded him to fill in the bubble in the separate answer sheet. My high hopes for him went down when he gave me this sad and confused look when he pointed at the problem for question number one and then pointed to the answer sheet. He saw number four in the problem, looked up at me, then looked back down at his answer sheet and filled out the random bubble on the row question number four, not question one. Then he looked up at me again. So here's this very touching situation of a kid who's really trying to engage with learning. He understands that a lot is being expected of him. And he's being given a task that he has not been prepared for. He does not know how to do the standardized testing form. And so this is an example of disengagement. The other thing that we focused on were teacher attitudes and teacher strategies and how they worked with these kids. The first has to do with assimilationist and multicultural attitudes that we felt that the teachers held. The teachers did not neatly divide into assimilationists and those who were multicultural, and teachers, the same teacher could hold both of those attitudes at different times, but essentially those who were more assimilationist felt that that the students should learn American cultural norms, learn and use English, understand, respect, and follow school rules, and give up their cultural practices in the process. And they also felt that they should not be flexible and that they should not make accommodations for these students. So the students had to learn how to be in school and to be in the U.S., whereas multicultural attitudes were much more accepting of the children's culture, wanting to bring in their ways of doing things into the classroom, and making exceptions and bending rules when they felt that it would help the kids. For example, there were students, the girls, for example, were not participating in sports in PE class when we first began, in part because of the clothing that they were wearing, because they wore long skirts. And the teacher who really wanted them to become engaged met with the parents and they talked about different solutions. And the solution that they came up with was that the girls would wear slightly looser skirts, still long, but underneath them they would wear pants and sneakers, and that way they could participate in gym class. And that was sort of a very creative solution, bending the rules essentially. They did not make them change into uniforms, but making the education accessible to them. A couple of strategies that teachers used, one of them was just affirmation, helping students feel good about what they were doing, even when they could not master a task right away. And here's an example of a teacher who asked a child to use a blackboard instead of paper so that he could write something and then erase it. And this seemed to work very well for her. So I want to finish up there. We have a lot of more examples and about what was going on with these kids and teacher strategies and so forth in the paper, but I just want to leave you with a couple of thoughts. The first is that we found the concept of academic engagement, and Carola Suarez Orozco has expanded on this, and she talks about academic engagement for immigrant students as having cognitive, behavioral, and relational components. And we found that a very useful concept in thinking about what the kids were going through, but of course we found the challenges that they faced as more extreme, as usually seen with immigrant kids, so that they were not cognitively engaged because they didn't even have the basic skills, and that they were behaviorally disengaged because they didn't know how to be in school, not because they were trying to be flippant about the school rules. And then relational engagement with the teachers in particular was a very helpful strategy that teachers employed. And secondly, that teacher attitudes did seem to allow, teachers who held multicultural attitudes had a lot more strategies available to them for how to work with the kids. And in fact, we found that even though some teachers felt that they should not change and the school should insist on its rules and not bend them, that in fact, being that rigid sometimes created more problems for the school. And in fact, being more flexible would have eased the situation much more for everyone, including the teachers. For example, when they were being rigid with respect to a rule and not allowing a child to participate in something, and the child would cry, and then somebody would have to deal with the child crying and address those concerns, sometimes slightly bending those rules and allowing the child to participate may have been a much more inclusive way to approach this, and also would have helped everybody go through this process. And finally, I'll just say we were in the school for 2 years, and we did note that in the second year, as the kids became acclimated to the school, as the new kids were arriving and those who were already there were able to help them acclimate, and the teachers learned to work with them, things did get a lot easier, and there were fewer incidents that we observed, and there was more engagement and learning. So things do shift and do change, but these initial interactions were particularly complex.
Okay, I'd like to say thanks to all of the presenters very much. Now, we've promised the people on the phone an opportunity to answer their questions. I'm going to leave hopefully around a half an hour for that, and that may mean that some of you will have to stay on a little bit longer than anticipated. As a reminder, use the Q&A chat function on the right-hand side of the screen or send an email to events@migrationpolicy.org to ask the questions. So one of the first questions that came up, I think, is in general for the three presenters, and I think it is very interesting. I know some of this information, I think some of these specifics were actually in some of the papers, but are there any training programs or consultation programs that can help teachers manage refugee student behavior in a culturally responsive way? In other words, is there any assistance out there, any sort of programs that can help teachers bridge the gaps that the three of you have discussed? And I would ask whoever goes first on this to please identify yourself as you're responding to the question.
This is Dina, and I will say programs and training opportunities are very local and based in school districts, but there are a couple of resources that I have relied on in the past that I think are quite good. One is BRICS.org. It's BRYC.org, which is Bridging Refugee Youth and Children's Services. And they have a number of orientation materials, best practice descriptions and programs, and a lot of other resources available. And the other one is SpringInstitute.org. And Spring Institute is in Denver, and they also have a number of resource materials for teachers, some of which I've published with them.
I can follow up on this as well. This is Sarah Dryden-Peterson. In countries of first asylum, we also, like Dina's saying, see many local initiatives to help teachers really engage with the needs of their refugee students. There are some international non-governmental organizations like the International Rescue Committee and Save the Children that have worked really hard to develop programs that are able to work with teachers to help them understand the previous experiences of refugee children and the kinds of academic and psychosocial supports that refugee children need in order to be integrated into classrooms. And oftentimes we see the most really impactful kinds of supports, both in the U.S. and in countries of first asylum, happening at even more local levels where, like Dina was describing, individual teachers are building relationships with refugee children and refugee families or reaching out to local organizations, refugee organizations, immigrant organizations, or reaching out to leaders within refugee communities who can help to bridge some of what can be misunderstandings or gaps in understanding between teachers, other parents, and refugee parents as well.
I have sort of a follow-up question, which I think is more so for Sarah or Selchuk, which is, you know, going to the countries of the first asylum case, are there ways in which technology, online educational platforms, for instance, are there ways in which technology could bridge the quality gap in schooling in countries of first asylum?
Hi, this is Selchuk. You know, this is a very new conversation. I mean, I don't know any successful case, but you know, I'm involved with 10th Foundation. They are considering Kindle-based education. It seems like that's going to be the future because we are talking about around 60 million refugees in the world, which is the largest ever, as you know. And most of them are children, and these are mobile now. You know, they are not settled in one country, one city, one camp, as it used to be. They are now moving from one city to another and one country to another. So we are talking about years of gaps between formal education where they left the country and settled at the end. That could be 3, 4, 5 years process. So we are talking about a huge gap in their educational process. And I think technology can really work some wonders here. One idea which are, you know, some ideas tested on the ground in Africa through Kindle. I know one example. So that may be an option going forward. We are very early stages as a team here at NYU to consider this in Jordan with Larry Abert leading an effort there. But I don't know any successful case where we have this in place as of this year.
What? Some of the lessons, this is Sarah Dryden-Peterson, some of the lessons that we've learned from an initiative in the Dadaab refugee camps in northern Kenya actually relate to higher education, but I think are relevant to other levels of education as well. A program there that we've begun called the Borderless Higher Education for Refugees, it's a blended online and face-to-face program that connects universities in Kenya and Canada to address some of the issues that Selchuk is talking about there in terms of uncertainty about where a future will be. So thinking about how is learning certified and how does that work in terms of currency depending on where refugees move, but also that schooling could be continued even if migration is ongoing, being able to access the online components in some ways. But what we've found through that experience, and Barbara Mercer-Moser at the University of Geneva has also done extensive work on this, is just how important the face-to-face component is. And this is not unique to refugee contexts, but being able to support any kind of online learning with actual interaction around content and interaction with teachers. And obviously that's not as easily scalable, but it seems to be the evidence pointing in the direction that that's just essential, that technology alone can't provide these kinds of answers, but can be a really important asset to work with, especially in refugee contexts.
Okay, I have a quick clarification question for Dina. Can you say a little bit more about the difference between LFE, limited formal education, and STIFE, students with interrupted formal education?
Yes, I can. So STIFE implies that students were in school, they were enrolled in school, then something happened and they missed schooling, you know, for a year, 2 years, multiple years, various periods of time. So when I first started to think about this, we actually wanted to apply that term to the Somali Bantu kids, but we realized that their schooling was never interrupted. They just never got to be in school. There was no formal schooling available to them. There were some limited experiences in refugee camps that they could have had, but most of them did not participate. And in fact, we were talking to one family and we said, well, there was a refugee camp, the school in the refugee camp. Did your children go? And they said, well, you know, we were thinking, we're going to America. Why should we send them to a camp school when we're going to America? So I think that for us, limited formal education stood for kids who had never been in school and, in fact, could not have participated in literacy activities, the way formal literacy activities, because their native language was not a written language within their home. So they experienced a more extreme situation than those for whom education was interrupted. Is that?
I have another question for you, Dina, which is, in your research, did you encounter any teachers who were refugees themselves? Do you have any thoughts on the pros and cons of having refugees themselves try to be teachers? There's one example one of the participants noted about some Burmese refugees that were able to become teachers in the United States.
We did encounter, and either immigrants or refugees. And I think that that's a very important topic for us to think about because one of the things we find in schools is that usually when you have marginalized students, usually teachers who teach them are also marginalized. And ESL teachers, for example, tend to be very marginalized in many schools. Some of them don't have a classroom. Some of them, you know, teach in the cafeteria, and some of them are not considered to be regular staff. And so when I think about that and then I think about teachers who are also refugees teaching refugee kids, it just seems like they have a tremendous number of things that they could bring to that experience, and yet I'm guessing they're not going to be supported in the school system the way they could be. So we have a lot of informal experience with that. There are some studies done with ESL teachers more generally about how marginalized they are. But I think that this is a very important topic to focus on because we could certainly learn a lot from teachers who are refugees themselves working with this population.
And then next I have a question which is for all three panelists. I'm not sure from anything in the papers that you address this, but to the extent that you can, it's a very specific question. Refugee children are arriving without documentation as to the amount and type of formal education that they've had in countries of first asylum. Can you speak to how, if you have noticed in any of your research, any better ways of providing documentation of the amount of the exact education that refugee children have had in first asylum countries?
This is Sarah Dryden-Peterson. I think This is obviously a critical issue, not just in coming to the U.S., but also for refugees who are in countries of first asylum, oftentimes are fleeing without any documents of previous educational experiences, and then documentation of their education in the country of first asylum may or may not be recognized as they engage in ongoing migration. One, I think, really interesting example of how to approach this issue was in West Africa during conflict in Liberia and Sierra Leone, where the West African Examinations Council was formed to really work together to have mutual recognition of educational credentials from Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea. And I think this kind of regional approach to thinking about documentation and certification is critical, especially because we know that most refugees do live locally to the conflict settings. But I think one of the other lessons that our research really points to is that the documentation may be much less valuable upon arrival in the U.S. than really thoughtful testing of students and working with students to understand where they are at and what kind of support they need in order to meet the grade level requirements. In countries of first asylum, we often see 14-year-olds sent back to the equivalent of first grade simply because they don't speak the language. They don't last very long in school. They need extra language support, but being with younger children who are just learning the language is not effective in that. And so in the U.S., how can we provide the kind of language support to catch refugee students up to the social and academic level that they need to be at? Even if they have proof of having finished primary school in a country of first asylum, that's not a guarantee that their academic skills will be at that same level upon arrival in the U.S.
Now, this is Dina, and the other issue I just want to raise is that, of course, this is much more of an issue for older kids, for late entering students who are high school age or so, because they will have missed more school, and it's more important even for them to have documents. And one of the things we're seeing in this country is that because of the pressures on schools, it's not in the best interest of schools to admit these students because of their fears that they will not have the time to complete their grade work and graduate. So the concern that principals have is that if they admit a student who is 14, 15, 16 from another country with missed education, they will not be able to graduate because they need the English and then they need to be able to complete their credits. So one of the things that we're seeing, and this is a terrible thing, but these students are sometimes being steered away from enrolling in school. And sometimes there's now been a rise of daytime GED programs for kids who are 16 and older as an alternative, which is on one hand a great thing because it gives these kids a place to go where they can complete their education. On the other hand, it's just really important to think about the policy implications of, you know, these pressures that schools are under so that they're not serving these kids in the way that they should. So that's it. And then the other thing, I don't know if the question had to do also with undocumented kids in the school system. And certainly there are a lot now in the U.S., and we don't know exactly how many because they are really under the radar, and it's very hard to know, to have any statistics on how many undocumented children are enrolled in U.S. schools, which is another very important issue for us to think about.
This is Salchuk. I just want to add one point, which is the verification of education degrees in particular is not as big of a problem for K through 12 transitions. You know, if you're within that age range, in some countries and under the UN rules, parents' verbal assessment or clarification maybe and should be enough, so you can negotiate on those grounds even if you don't have papers. The problem is going through the college level. So high school, without high school diploma, many countries do not accept anything but a diploma or paperwork, and that's where you see a lot of these kids not going to college, even though in the case of Syria, most of the kids under 18 have a degree or almost graduate from high school to go to college, and they cannot do it because there's no paperwork going to the next level.
Okay, now, and this is going to be, again, for all three presenters, we had a series of questions come in about mental health and how to deal with mental health, and one of those is around screening, you know, where's the best place and who should have the responsibility for mental health screening? Is that the resettlement agencies? What role should the schools play in screening? And then related to that, how can school counselors assist teachers with refugees in their classrooms to integrate socio-emotional development, mental health well-being in the classroom in terms of both classroom instruction and just in general support services? Does anyone want to go first on that one?
I can say this is South Chuck. I think we are all pausing partly because it's such a huge problem, you know, especially for U.S. I do work in New York City public schools. I know that the system is not really designed to help mental health problems when it is, you know, if it is serious. And in this case, you know, like the data that I share with you today, we are talking about serious help, not just a, you know, one visit a week kind of help. And quite frankly, our schools are not designed for this. So it can overwhelm you when you think about this. But the other side of the coin is, you know, what is the cost of not treating them? And I think we have to be cautious about the situation in the rest of the world where you have refugees who are going through all these symptoms, expressing huge high levels of PTSD in the case of war zone children. And, you know, what is the cost of not doing anything? So in that sense, I think school districts should take a serious look at the needs and design a special program for kids who just came out of war zones. And these are the kids that we are talking about in the case of Syrian refugees.
Yeah, I think this is Dina, and I, you're absolutely right. This is such a huge topic, and it's so frustrating to know that there's so little there for these kids. And absolutely, you know, schools need to do what Selchuk is saying. And, you know, at the very least, social workers and teachers need some education about where these kids are coming from and how to recognize symptoms of trauma, so perhaps they can provide referrals and create opportunities for kids just to talk and socialize and become integrated with other kids. But it's a terrible problem, and it's a travesty that that our society does not recognize this as a critical need for these kids.
This is Sarah, and just to add one point about the kinds of connections that can be so challenging for schools to build with health centers or local refugee and immigrant groups. But in research that we've done in the U.S., the schools in which the parents, the kids, and the teachers felt like they were doing the best job of meeting mental health needs really did involve these kind of partnerships. So schools recognizing that they could not do this alone and finding skilled partners within local health centers, which is of course not always the case because there's so few resources dedicated to this. And then engaging local refugee, again, community leaders who can do some of what you were talking about, Dina, in terms of educating school staff about the previous experiences of refugee kids and families.
And this is Selchuk again. Just you know, if you guys are interested, you should check what goes on in Norway, where they have more experience and more resources. So that would be one of the good examples of how to deal with unaccompanied minors, in particular when you are settling them in different parts of the country.
And actually, as you mentioned, unaccompanied minors, Selchuk, a question just came in that some of the unaccompanied refugee minor programs actually have funding for one-on-one tutoring after school with the unaccompanied children. Is there any possibility of funding a program like this for children in refugee families more generally? Any thoughts on how a program like that might work?
Well, you know, this is Selchuk again. I actually happened to do some research in Norway on unaccompanied minors, which they have one of the largest settlement of that kind of that population from Somalia and Afghanistan and Iraq. Per UN rules, the countries, when they accept unaccompanied minors, they have to allocate funding, additional funding for mental health needs, because we are talking about children, war zone, PTSD, plus no support network. Something like that for refugees, we do not have that in this country. I don't know if, you know, right now the pressure on Congress right now is to increase just the number. You know, we the fact that we only have 2,000 refugees speak for itself.
Well, this is Dina, and the U.S. resettlement program nationally, I mean, they do fund youth services, not a lot. And, you know, the focus of the refugee program has always been on economic self-sufficiency, right? So the first priority is that adults get jobs. But they do also, there is also an appreciation that, you know, the kids need things. And there are a number of states and local programs that receive ORR funds for youth programs, including after-school programs and summer camps and those kinds of things, and tutoring. Certainly there are a number of tutoring programs in different cities. So they are in place. Now, these are wonderful programs, and I'm really glad they exist, but they're not mental health programs, is, I think, the situation. But they do have, you know, a number of places do have them. Certainly states that handle refugee resettlement and programs that work with them tend to have some youth programs, at least.
This is Sarah. One of the things I think that we could learn a lot more about is the organizations that refugee families and refugee youth are creating without any kind of institutional support. A lot of what we see among Somali refugees, for example, is students in the DAB connecting with students in the U.S., in Canada, and forging real support networks transnationally, particularly those who are new to a level of education or new to a particular context, really trying to learn from those who've gone before them. And if there are ways to provide additional supports to those already existing local networks, there's a lot of really interesting relationships and support going on that, instead of being created from the outside, is internal within communities, even if it is transnational in nature.
Okay, and then I think I have one more sort of general question, which I'm also going to send back to you, Sarah, I think, as the first, and then also maybe Selchuk, you might want to chime in on this. Someone in the audience asked if you could elaborate on the quality of education, both in the camps and in other settings in first asylum countries. And I know there's a fair amount about this in both of your papers.
Sure. This is Sarah. I think one of the really important elements to emphasize is that the quality really varies, as we know from any kind of context. But in most refugee settings, we see teachers who have very little training who are teaching refugees. And this echoes what you were saying earlier, Dina, in terms of who teaches the most marginalized students, the most marginalized teachers with the fewest resources. And so in addition to unstable situations, either in camps or in cities, teachers with very little training and very few access to resources. That said, we see pockets of remarkable instruction going on. And in fact, I see this in particular when there are refugee teachers who see the work that they're doing with refugee students as a real calling, as a real passion. And so they're thinking about kind of wraparound care in many ways. They're thinking about the social and emotional needs of their students and understanding the background that they're coming from. They're thinking not only about that student today in their classroom, but what that student's aspirations are, and trying to mold the instruction to meet those kinds of aspirations. And I think we have a lot to learn from teachers who are doing remarkable things despite all odds, because the reality is that there's not enough funding for the kinds of resources that we would like to see in so many refugee settings or the kind of training. But focusing on these pockets of good practice, I think, will take us far.
This is Selchuk. You know, I agree with Dina's point about marginalized teachers and teaching staff and professionals in general who are serving this particular population in non-refugee settings. So that's certainly the case. For refugee camps, especially the ones that I am familiar with, which is, you know, in Turkey, if you are on camp, it's almost like there's a double bind there. When you're on the camp, you get quality education, partly because you're the teaching staff and everybody else, they get additional support from UN, Save the Children and other places, and they are more experienced to deal with children who came out of war zone. The problem there, of course, is the context. Outside of school, you do not have a living community, really. Jobs are not there, social, cultural services are not available. So when you're on any of this camp school, you may have an okay education, but nothing else. That's why families leave camp. They don't want to stay there. And then when they leave, you know, in most cases, they have to send their kids to regular schools who are not trained at all to deal with the needs of this particular population. And in the case of Turkey, we are talking about, you know, more than 1 million children there, right? We are talking about children who are speaking a language that's not taught in schools, and none of the teaching staff has that kind of background. So it's a huge problem. We keep, I keep going back to the same point. The problem is so big, it can really frustrate you easily. And so in a way, I'm trying to alarm our audience here and everywhere else, really, that we have to pay attention to this problem. Otherwise, it's gonna cost us even more in the future.
And Selçuk, if I can just jump on one of the things that you said there that I think is really important, is that we know that refugee crises last for a really long time, that most refugee families think that when they're first displaced, they might go home in 6 months, they might go home in a year, but that the average length of displacement is 17 years. But the resources dry up really quickly. And so while there are oftentimes the kinds of supports that you're describing in terms of outside NGOs and additional teacher training and additional supports, and obviously this varies on the context, it also really changes with time. And so when one crisis fades from the news and fades from donor support, there are very few of those kinds of supports that are just as needed in a long-term protracted situation as in an emergency.
Okay, well, I would like to thank the presenters very, very much, and the audience as well. We were able to answer most but not all the questions, and I do apologize. I think in general, we tried to select the questions that were most focused on the education. There were some broader immigration policy questions we were not able to address in the time we had allotted. The slides and audio from today's webinar are going to be available at www.migrationpolicy.org/events, and please, I urge everyone in the audience to share that link, as well as the links to the three reports that are shown below here. For more information in general, if you want to contact me, you see my email at the top there. For media, for reporters, please contact Michelle Mittelstadt, Director of Communications, and her email and phone number are there as well. And of course, as always, for additional information and to receive updates on various immigration policy issues, visit our website. Thanks once again to everyone for joining the call today.